views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Pursuant to Chapter 4, Section 85 of the New York City Charter, a meeting of the Bronx Borough Service Cabinet will take place on Wednesday, June 7th, 2017 at 9:15 a.m. at 198 East 161st Street, 10th floor conference room. We have two items on the agenda, the enforcement and summer programs. There's a presentation by the New York City Parks and Recreation, and also the Hydrant Education Action Team, which is called HEAT. We have a presentation by South Bronx Overall Economic Development, SOBRO. So without any further ado, I'd like to welcome Michael Dockett, the Assistant Commissioner for Parks, as well as our own Iris Rodriguez, our Bronx Commissioner. We thank you for being here. And I don't quite know your, I know there's a David Calderon and an Edwin Rodriguez. You're Edwin Rodriguez. Okay. Thank you. Well, thank you all for being here. And without any further ado, you can make your presentation.
Yes, thank you, Madam Borough.
Now, I'm going to need you to talk into the microphone.
Okay. Yes. Well, good morning, everyone. For me, it's been a pleasure. Actually, this month I make 2 years as your borough commissioner. So for me, it's been an honor and a privilege and a pleasure to be here. Thank you. I've had the distinct pleasure of being able to work with each and every one of you here in this room in one fashion or another. So, and I will continue to do that and address many of the situations and conditions that may exist in many of your districts and the interests. And I like to think that I've tried to do that in the last couple of years. One of the things that I wanted to share with you, so I will be distributing during the course of the meeting after the Assistant Commissioner and Edwin Rodriguez talk about the park enforcement, I will be distributing some of the summer programs because I want you all to understand that the Parks Department is about operations and maintaining our parks, about trying our very best to try to keep our parks safe, and also providing adequate programming. And we've expanded many of our programs to be able to do movies in your parks, to be able to do performances in the parks, to be able to do active fitness programs in the parks. So we're very proud of that, you know, aspect of it. And of course, if you have any suggestions or any ideas at other locations that we can possibly be able to improve in terms of programming, we'd also like to be able to do that. With many of you, of course, I've worked on many capital project presentations that we've done over the last couple of years, and we will continue to do so. This administration has seen fit to be able to provide the Community Park Initiative, which many of you know about, was able to put almost $300 million in terms of equity funds throughout the city for parks that have not received any kind of capital funding for almost 20 years. So I think it's important, and we're always looking for partners. We're always looking for the elected officials to be able to partner with us. Having been a former district manager myself, I understand the value of what the community boards represent and their advocacy role and how they meet up with their constituencies to try to service them. So I personally am very akin to the community boards and what they provide. One of the things that I realized, we presented on forestry a few months ago, I believe, park enforcement seems to be something that's very important. And we've tried to address, there are many, many issues. There's never going to be, what I feel, enough park enforcement officers to be able to do much of the work that needs to be done, because we have what we call hotspots. So we try to deal with what we call the hotspot areas and try to address it with enforcement and with special attention. But of course, there are a myriad of issues that may occur in many of our parks. Well, we have almost 400 parcels in the borough alone. So I'd like to be able to now have our park enforcement. I actually wanted the park enforcement to be able to present what they've done, because I think Martin Prince can attest to the fact of some of the task force that we've prepared to try to do. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Assistant Commissioner Michael Dockett of Park Enforcement.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Good morning.
And thank you, Chair. So my name is Mike Dockett. I've been with Parks for 33 years. Many of those years spent here in the Bronx. I was an urban park ranger in Cortona Park, in Van Cortlandt Park. I have fond memories of those days. My current position is Assistant Commissioner. I oversee the Park Enforcement Patrol, so security at parks citywide, as well as the Central Communications Division, beach and pool operations, and emergency management. So I'm here today. I brought along the Inspector of Park Enforcement Patrol, Edwin Rodriguez, who oversees the day-to-day operations citywide, and your local Bronx captain, one of two, David Calderon, who oversees day-to-day operations in the Bronx. I'm going to give you a little intro into Park Enforcement Patrol. So all of our officers are New York State peace officers and New York City special patrolmen. So they have arrest powers. The special patrolman designation in New York City gives the police commissioner jurisdiction over the quality of our officers and the background investigation and that type of thing. So we work closely with New York City Police in vetting our employees, and they're helping us training aspects as well. All of our officers go through a 12-week training course. And when they come out, they have the ability to write criminal court summonses, civil summonses that are returnable to oath. They can write the Department of Consumer Affairs summonses, parking violations, moving violations, and enforce some of the health regs. So we bring these tools to bear in parks. Now, the enforcement officer's focus, though, is not the penal law. It's really park rules and regulations, right? So that's the stuff like your dog's off the leash, or you're climbing a tree, you can't have a barbecue here. We're protecting parkland, so we're preventing folks from damaging it, graffitiing, that type of stuff. But we also enforce the penal law, so if they see crimes being committed in their presence, they will make those arrests. So primarily, the philosophy for Park Enforcement Patrol is to be that friendly but firm presence in the park, to be that uniform presence, the person you can go to when you're hurt, you need to know where the bathrooms are, you need assistance, you need help with your event, and to kind of maintain order in the park as well. So they will instruct you, put your dogs on a leash, that type of thing. Can't barbecue here, but you can barbecue over there, those type of things. And our first step is just to educate the public. Hey, these are the park rules. You may not be aware. I'll give you an opportunity to comply with them. Right, and typically most people do, because the folks that are coming to the parks are typically law-abiding family folks that are enjoying the parks in a respectable manner. And then when they're not and when they don't comply, that's where we would go to the civil summons. Sometimes that escalates beyond that. So you have a baseline of 54 officers that are assigned to the Bronx, right? So that's what we try to fill. Currently, we have 13 vacancies there. We have people on leave of absence. We have people in training academy. But year-round, you can expect to have about 54 officers when we get to full staffing. And then they're split up throughout the borough. So right now, that means two captains, nine sergeants, 30 officers, right? Because totally, currently, 41 shielded officers out there. When I say shielded, I mean people with arrest powers. We also have another division called the Park Security Service. And these are security type officers that don't have arrest powers, right? So they don't go through the 12-week training program, but they do go through an 8-day training program where they're given mental health first aid, report writing, how to respond to emergencies, CPR. They also wear a uniform and they're out in parks, and they kind of bolster the work of the Park Enforcement Patrol. So by the third week of June, we'll have 77 of these officers deployed throughout the Bronx. Some of them are year-round and are deployed in regional parks, and others are joining us to do security at the beaches and pools. So the beach security officers are already out there. The Park Security Service has two components to it. One is a welfare to work program where we're training folks that are receiving public assistance in the work of being a security guard. So they're working alongside Park Enforcement Patrol officers. They're supervised by Park Enforcement Patrol sergeants, and they get a real rigorous training and a rigorous job opportunity where, you know, you get in trouble if your shoes aren't shined and you haven't shaved, that kind of stuff. You have to be to work on time. It's very disciplined. And the folks that graduate this program typically do well and find outside employment in security or other fields. They get a really rigorous job program and tend to be successful in finding employment afterwards. I'm going to turn it over at this point to, I also wanted to mention that we have a small mounted unit, and they're based here in the Bronx in Van Cortlandt Park. So we have two horses there, and there's three officers and a hostler that kind of care for those horses. So they're out patrolling, primarily Van Cortlandt Park, but then they also trailer to other parks in the borough. And they're a big uniform presence. It's an ambassador-type role. That's always a magnet for kids and tourists and residents to come up. They've never seen a horse in a park before. But it's also a big law enforcement deterrent. You know, you have someone high up, they can see. They write a lot of summonses in Van Cortlandt Park, which is where they patrol. And then we also have a unit that kind of works very close with the Department of Homeless Services here in the Bronx, Bronx Works. And we do a lot of outreach to any homeless individuals that are found in our park. And it's a very compassionate approach. I'd like to thank Bronx Works for their partnership. So I'd like to turn it over to the Park Enforcement Patrol Inspector, Edwin Rodriguez, who'll tell you about the different initiatives that are going on in the Bronx.
Thank you. After speaking with reviewing the 311 complaints and speaking to the district managers for MNO, I have instructed the borough captain to concentrate our enforcement efforts on the illegal vendors who're selling alcohol in the parks, the illegal barbecues, and amplified music. So the borough captain has been concentrating on Katona Park, Pelham Bay Moors, Ferry Point, and Bronx Park. I mean, the biggest issue we have is the illegal alcohol vendors, because people get drunk and then it escalates. Also the illegal barbecue. So Captain Calderon put out special teams on the weekend and they concentrate on these parks. I mean, we also concentrate on St. Mary and other parks, but those parks are pretty much under control, but these are our hotspots. So our efforts are on these parks, and we hit them every weekend.
Okay.
We'll take a question.
I just wanted to say that we are trying to also address some of the concerns when we talk about illegal barbecuing, because one of the things we want to have people understand is that sometimes people want to barbecue near playgrounds. Okay, think about the danger and the aspect of having children in the playground and having people barbecuing nearby and things like that, the hot coals, et cetera. So that's definitely something that we have to address and we continue to address. But I'm also looking at spots that we can also designate as barbecue areas that are open lawn areas, because as we know, we have a lot of individuals that in terms of the dwellings that we have here that are looking for places to be able to barbecue. Mm-hmm. So on that note, we have definitely opened up now the Claremont Park area. There's going to be a designated area in Claremont Park that's going to be for barbecuing. We're looking also at Soundview Park, an area in Soundview Park to be able to also designate as a barbecue area. So as that came in 2 years ago, I saw that was one of the needs. So definitely Claremont Park is starting right away, and we're looking at a location at Soundview Park that we all agree on to be able to place that as well. So I just wanted to be able to share that with you. One of the things that we've done is one of the things, Ferry Point. So I'd like to be able to talk a little bit, if you don't mind, about Ferry Point. I had made a commitment to Community Board 10 to be able to address it was really seriously out of control. It had about 20 vendors out there illegally vending. And as you know, I know that people want to make a living and things of that nature, but you know what? It's also, we have to be mindful that if someone has some of that food and they get sick and things like that, we cannot ignore that you're supposed to have permits, that they're supposed to be revenue, they're supposed to have permits with revenue, they're supposed to have food handlers permits, etc., many of the things. So I just wanted to share with you how we started. One of the things that I do as borough commissioner is foretold is forewarned. So I actually took all the permit holders and I had them at the table, and we met with Captain Calderon and we met with all the permit holders and say, listen, we're going to be enforcing this year, so I don't want it to be a surprise. Mm-hmm. So that way, at least you're very much aware of what's going on. Not only did we do that, but we further, to try to help the constituency, we said, okay, we're going to teach you the steps that are needed if, in case individuals want to vent in the park. These are the resources or the things that you need to be able to do in order to be able to obtain or to be eligible to be able to vend in a park. And we actually bought the permit holders themselves, they brought about 20 people to the table to be able to learn that you have to have food handlers permits, you had to do, et cetera. So we went that step further to do that. Now, we also met with the 45th precinct. We met with the 45th precinct and park enforcement. So we took step by step to make sure that people cannot say that we did not try to be engaging with the community, okay, which is very important. Now, I think I've asked the chairperson, have you gone to the park? I think the borough president was very much interested. I think the borough president was interested to see how we were dealing with that. And I think the outcome right now has been very good. Now the permit holders themselves are complaining that maybe we're, you know, being a little bit too rough, but we're not being rough. We're actually enforcing the park's rules and regulations correctly, as we should. So I just wanted to give you an example of some of the things that we're trying to address. And of course, we have issues with Marshallu and Pelham Parkway, because actually the parkways are not recreational areas per se, active recreation. I want people to understand the difference between passive recreation and active recreation. Passive recreation is you can run, you can sit, you can play chess, you can do things, and parkways are meant for that. But the active recreation is when people go and do barbecuing or do playing soccer and things of that nature. And if you look at the parkways, think about the fact that if you have a child that's playing a soccer ball and goes into the roadway, it's a dangerous situation. And luckily, it hasn't happened, but we have to be mindful of that. So on that note, I just wanted to be able to share some of the things that we've done. So I guess we'll open it up for questions.
Yeah. Thank you. That was very comprehensive. I want to go back to the picnic areas or the barbecue areas in Claremont Park. Are they going to be, there are going to be signs up to say that this is the area you can barbecue in?
Yes, there will be signs saying that this is the designated area. And as a matter of fact, our deputy commissioner, we're trying some, I think, some new grills that I have never seen before. So it should be, so we'll, once we get the grills, we're going to put a concrete slab so we can put the grills on. So we're experimenting with that as well.
Right. And a much more difficult issue for you to address is the noise, the loud music. Are you doing anything, or can you do anything to help abate it so that people are more considerate of others?
So to have amplified music in a park, you need a permit. So park enforcement officers can go up to people with and ask to see their permit when they don't have it. And that permit comes from the police department, right? So it's also followed up by a parks permit if they have a big group. So we do look at those groups and tell them, turn it down, you can't have it. You can have some sound, but you can't have the big boombox DJ, that kind of setup, without a parks permit. So I don't know, Dave, do you want to talk about our success? Maybe join us.
You can use one of these.
I thought I had a loud enough voice. Our offers have been, if they encounter amplified sound and there is no permit, we make them take it back and put it in their vehicles or take it out of the park completely. So far, we have no problems. We've had everyone complying.
Okay.
And removing their amplified sound out of the park.
And then in prior years, we've had complaints, like from the Chandler Recreation Area in Van Cortlandt, of people being in the parking lots, say, after 10 o'clock, amplified music coming out of the cars, that type of things. So for that, we enforced a curfew. We closed the lot, we let people know, shut it down, move them out, and I think that was rather successful.
Yes, it has been. We close it down at 7 o'clock, lock it up, and no one's allowed back there after 7.
Okay, good. Are there any questions or comments? Let me get to George first, and then I'll get to Mr. Hill.
Thank you. So PEP officers and enforcement has been an issue that I've raised since I've become a district manager back in 2015. And we've brought this up during budget consultations. And I'm just curious, because my point back then was it more effective to just get rid of the PEP officers? You were here when we had this conversation. Completely, and just give that money to the NYPD, because it seems like there's always a reduction in your staff. Now, I know that, I don't know if it was this administration actually gave more money, you were able to hire more people, but I also know that private entities like the Highline Park in Manhattan have also contributed to having a full-time dedicated PEP officer staff. I don't think any of our parks have donors that are that rich that can, you know, supplement, the New York City Parks Department's ability to sort of staff up our people. So I'm curious, in relation to the number of complaints that you've received, 311, have they gone up in recent years or have they gone down in relation to complaints about parks? And what has your staffing as a result looked like? I mean, what was PEP officers in its heyday? How many did we have as opposed to now?
Okay, when I started in this position about 12 years ago, we were at 81 PEP officers citywide. We're currently a little under 300. So it has steadily increased. I'm not sure where the heyday is that you're referring
to. So you have more PEP officers in the last 12 years?
Absolutely, more now. Yeah, we were more at now. 292.
So where does that argument come from when people always say that, you know, there aren't enough PEP officers? I mean, am I misunderstanding the argument? Because again, I started in August of 2015, and that's been the number one question that I've had in regards to staffing here. Is it that because you have people who are able to pay, like the Highline Park, for their own dedicated officers, and they're there full time, that you have less officers in other boroughs?
Okay, so
is that the case?
The way the grant-funded officers work is that's in addition to tax levy officers. We don't put tax levy resources there. So if a group like NYU and surrounding community for Washington Square Park want to fund either the park security officers or park enforcement officers, and they raise the money to do that, we are happy to provide that extra security for the parks, but we go out and hire someone for that. It's an addition, so it doesn't take away anything from a Bronx park to put these other officers in other parks, and actually it provides job opportunity for people, and it also allows us in emergencies to use that staff to pull them wherever is needed. So we have about 77 or so grant-funded officers around the city. So during 9/11, during Sandy, they were all redeployed, Staten Island and the Rockaways for the most part. As well as kind of maintaining skeleton crews where they were. So it's a additional help for us. It provides promotional opportunities for our officers to supervise staff in those sites. So we see it as a positive thing. We don't have too grant-funded officers here in the Bronx, but you have a baseline of 54 officers for this borough. So we can always use more. So I think that's the argument, is that, you know, we do go 7 days a week. So when you take your 54, 7 days a week, and you do multiple tours, right? So the argument is, I don't see a lot of them. Our officers do mobile patrols, so they go from park to park, right? And if you look at the grant-funded officers, they just stay in the one park.
If I can comment on that as well. Back in 2015, is this thing on? Okay. Back in 2015, we only had less than 20 officers. Now, I think Sunday when the academy graduates, I'm going to have 40. So that's twice as many, which allows me to be able to put officers in Bronx Park, all our hot spots like Katona, Pelham Parkway, Pelham Park. So we're able to concentrate in those areas now, where before, back in 2015, I couldn't concentrate on that. I had to have those 20 officers doing the whole borough, and that was it. I couldn't concentrate on single parks here and there to hit those problem areas when we had them.
And the 40 officers is covering two tours and also Orchard Beach. One thing I like about the grant-funded officers, like we have in Washington Square Park, Madison Square Park, now the tax levy officers, doesn't have to go to those parks, so I can use them to hit other parks. So that's one benefit of having the grant-funded offices.
My final question will be...
Can I add, George, can I just add that? One of the things that some of the other boroughs, and I will say this respectfully, out of the expense budget, some elected officials have been able to appropriate funds specifically for a particular area to be designated. So just to keep that in mind, so just to know that also the elected officials can do that as well.
My final question, so... since you've ramped up and it seems like it's going in the right direction, do we feel, is this an adequate number, or do you feel like you need more? I'm asking because, again, we're going to be going through budget consultation shortly, and, you know, we have to make requests of the city. So are we good on PEP officers, or is there a magic number that we should be aiming for?
You know, we could always use more resources in Park Enforcement Patrol or in the Park Security Service, you know. But the 54 baseline number for the Bronx, what that gets us is a uniform presence in our park from 8 a.m. to 10 o'clock at night. It gives us a fixed post at Crotona Park over two tours. Crotona Park has come up on the crime stats as one of the, you know, it's within the top five. So we focus there. We have officers assigned there. Out of Mill Pond, which is just down the block from here, that's the main headquarters for PEP. It gives us the officers there to cover two tours, to cover the borough. It allows for supervision in the pools. It allows for supervision at the beach. So we're comfortable with that number, being able to provide a lot of resources for the Bronx. But of course, we can always do more, you know. So.
Just to keep in mind that because of the turnover rate, because many of our officers also, they sort of, it's a prelude to them going into NYPD and things of that nature. It is always, they're always constantly recruiting. So please be mindful of that as well.
Mr. Hill?
Bill Hall, Chair 412. Just a quick question. Do you have an enforcement presence on the midnight tour at all? From 12 to midnight?
No, we work from 8 to 12 midnight. We don't have an overnight tour.
No, okay. And my other question was, if a crime is committed in the park and it spills over into the city, do you have your people have authority to pursue that, or do they have to call NYPD to chase or whatever they may have to do?
Well, we will notify NYPD right away, but mm-hmm. if there's a crime in the park and we're allowed to leave our jurisdiction,
you
to
go
after them,
into.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a citywide unit. Mm-hmm. So. While we don't have any midnight to 8 a.m. tour, when there are problems on the overnight, we just schedule officers to work that tour. So if you have a particular, say there's an encampment or a particular issue that's happening in the overnight hours, we kind of get information from the district managers, from the park supervisors, and then we just put together a little team to kind of go deal with that at night. And a lot of times we do that in conjunction with NYPD. Okay. So that's like for illegal dumping, those kind of issues. Yeah.
Mr. Prince.
Martin Prince, Chair of Community Board 10. Just wanted to take the moment. You did call us out for your efforts at Ferry Point and the other areas of CB10. And I just want to acknowledge that. You work very closely. We work very closely together along with the precinct. And this gives me an opportunity to say on the record, thank you for those efforts. I've seen the improvements, and I'm looking forward to continuing working on those issues. So thank you.
Raphael.
For the presentation. I do want to acknowledge also that in Community Board 2, we've been working very well with Parks Department. They allocated a lot of money to some older parks that we had, and just looking to continue this, you know, building on the strength that we have with Parks Department. But I do have two parks in my district that I do have some enforcement concerns with. The first one is Juan Caraballo Ballfield, and I know that the commissioner mentioned their relationship with Bronx Works, but this is directly across the street from their drop-in center. And we've been finding a lot of individuals going into the park and building encampments, laying out on the grass overnight. And we have a basketball court right there. So there's a lot of interaction with the clients from Bronx Works. And residents that are utilizing the park. Then the second one is Concrete Plant Park. So Concrete Plant Park, you have to enter through Westchester Avenue, and it's a ramp that goes down. And the Bronx River Alliance does a great job of maintaining the park, but we've been getting a lot of complaints of illegal dumping. And they're actually finding about 40 to 50 tube televisions being dumped. So it's someone specific. It's not regular rubbish. And every 3 or 4 months, they have to organize volunteers to actually come and clean this up. So it's just something that I want to bring to your attention, because it's these are concerns that are being brought to me in my district. So, but no, there's no other main issues with enforcement. And overall, we have a great relationship with parks. But these are things that I just want to bring to your radar, in particular that the summer months are coming now. So in Juan Caraballo Ballfield, we are really concerned about these individuals setting up encampments actually at that park. So thank you.
Caraballo Fields, we're working with Bronx Works and getting that under control. It has been brought to my attention, and I have reached out to Bronx Works, and they guarantee me that they are going to get that under control. I will follow up on it. And Concrete Park is funny, because we're going to do plain clothes in there. That was brought to my attention last week. So we're going to set up a plain clothes and do a stakeout, and hopefully catch whoever's dumping.
Great.
Thank you. My deputy inspector, Edwin Falcone, who's a resident of Bronx, works very close with DHS, so I'll make sure he's aware of this situation.
I was the program director for the homeless outreach program. So I worked very well at one point with Marlene Giga and Jerry Cordero, So we started it on the overnight, addressing all these other parks. So it's something that I'm very familiar with, and I'm also a resident of Manida Street. So it's something where I see this all the time, and it's being brought to my attention. And then the Concrete Park is also in my district, and we're getting a lot of activity happening at Concrete Park. We're doing the foodway there. We had the movie Under the Stars there recently there. So there's a lot going on, and I just want to make sure that it's on your guys' radar. And anything that we can do on a board level to assist, we'll be more than happy to. So thank you.
Okay. John Dudley.
Good morning. Thanks, Amelia. Let me ask you, I know you mentioned, how you doing, Commissioner? I know you mentioned we have 54 officers. You said there were 13 vacancies now. Well, are they expected to be filled? I mean, what were the circumstances involving the vacancies, and how soon were they supposed to be filled?
Yeah, sure. I don't have the exact breakdown of the 13 vacancies, but it's between people on leave of absence, could be maternity, military leave, and just vacancies, turnover. People have moved on to other agencies. So we're constantly recruiting, and we have an academy that's starting on the 19th. They won't let out until around Labor Day, and you'll get some staff out of that.
Okay, so in the fall, you would anticipate a full complement, or what
you
think to be a full complement?
Yeah, we're constantly striving to get up to the full complement.
Okay. Of, so the 30, of the 31 that you have now.
41.
41, you said? Of the 41, I know you mentioned Crotona. Crotona's in District 3.
Right.
Is there a dedicated assignment of PEP officers for Crotona?
There is.
It is. And what would that figure be?
Dave, what's the current staffing there?
Excuse me?
I'm asking a
count. Oh, okay.
I'm going through my head. Yeah. There's three sergeants and 15 officers divided between.
So it's like a 1-to-5 ratio, pretty much.
Pretty much, yes, pretty much a 1-to-5.
And that's dedicated for Crotona.
That's dedicated to Crotona.
So where they're working out of the boathouse when they do?
No, they're working out of the.
They work out of the boathouse.
Out of the.
Yes.
Oh shoot! I'm sorry.
No. That's the least of them. So that, and how? What, I know you mentioned two tours. Are they there? How often?
7 to 3 and 2 to 10.
7 to 3 and 2 to 10. So they work.
7 in the morning to 3 in the afternoon. 2 in the afternoon to 10 at night.
To 10 o'clock
7 days
at
a
night.
Week.
Is it how many? 7 days a week.
Yes.
So they were in Crotona.
Yes.
And how are the numbers in terms of illicit activities, illegal vending, issues that they would otherwise enforce? Because I liked hearing what I heard in terms of, other than just enforcing the administrative code by way of VCB, there's some criminal leverage and civil leverage that they have.
I mean, if you want exact numbers, I'm going to have to share that with you at a later date.
Yeah, okay. I can give you the numbers from 2016. So they wrote, this is not just for Crotona, but it's for the Bronx. There were 492 civil violations issued, right?
Okay.
And 1,179 parking violations issued. 4 criminal court summons issued in the Bronx. Many of those parking violations, there's issues along Crotona Park East, the double parking, things like that. But I don't have the specific Crotona Park breakdown.
Okay, thanks.
But we could get that for you.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Are there any other questions or comments? Iris?
Okay, so if there are no questions or comments, I want to thank our Assistant Commissioner Michael Dockett, Edwin Rodriguez, and Calderon for being here this morning and sharing the information. And of course, we'll always continue. The district manager and the community boards will continuously call us and let us know situations. But on a lighter note, so before closing, I just want to be able to give you, we have some information here, because the other side of the agency is, of course, the public program side of it. It's June. It's the beginning of June. We're coming up with a lot of programs that are going to be happening throughout the borough. So I want to be able to leave some of this information here. I have 6 documents here that you should note. I have the cards for the recreation centers that show tell you that we have youth, adult, and senior programs in our recreation centers. I have a flyer here that talks about the mobile recreation vans. Many of you know what this is. We have a playground van and a fitness van. And what we try to do is make sure that it goes around throughout the borough, through the different different parks. And sometimes community organizations ask for them. We have what we call arts and culture in the park as well, to be able to show, provide events, performances, throughout the parks in the borough. We have movie schedules. This administration actually gave us a movie van, because it used to be a citywide movie van that we had to just solicit some dates from it, but now each borough has their own vans and we're able to provide movies on for the borough itself. We have a puppet mobile, which is great for the younger kids to be able to see puppet shows, and we have a puppet schedule here. And finally, I have also Adventures NYC, which is June 17th, which is it's actually being held in Central Park, but we always want the boroughs to be able to go and experience something more active to be able to do that. So having come from the public program side of the agency, of course, I have to advocate that. And in closing, I have to say that when we talk about parks and not-for-profit and private partnerships, I have to give a shout-out to Mr. Caballero for many, many, many years. Back in the 90s, we were able to convert a St. James Recreation Center from just a one single programming for seniors to a multi-service for seniors and youth and after-school programs, because they were able to provide the funding through the not-for-profit status. So I have to give him a shout-out. And again, thank you to all the district managers, to the chair people of the community boards, and thank you for being such great partners with the Parks Department.
Okay. Want to thank you all for coming in. You gave us a very comprehensive report, and we thank you for the work that you're doing. Thank you. We now have a presentation from SOBRO on the Hydrant Education Action Team called HEAT. Sandy Ramirez will be making the presentation. Sandy? Okay. Send all these with you. Oh, you have enough? Okay, let me.
Do I start?
You can start, Sandy, when you're ready.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning. Happy Wednesday. It's an honor and a pleasure to talk to you about SoBro's HEAT program, funded by New York City's Department of Environmental Protection. HEAT is an acronym for the Hydrant Education Action Team. Raise your hands if you've seen kids playing with a full-on blast fire hydrant during the summer months. I know I have. Yeah. Yes, it's a very common sight. Some residents are unaware of how illegally open fire hydrants affect the environment by wasting New York City's water resource. It could also prevent firefighters' ability to put out fires. It decreases the water pressure in apartments and businesses, making it impossible to do everyday activities like showering, cooking, and even having running water. The HEAT program doesn't intend to stop New York City's tradition of playing with the fire hydrants, but to educate the residents on the legal and safe ways of opening the fire hydrants. The HEAT team advocates and promotes the use of spray caps as a safe and environmentally effective solution to the problem, and it urges New Yorkers to put a cap on it. By using a spray cap, the amount of water pumped out is reduced from 1,000 gallons of water per minute to a safe level of just 25 gallons per minute. Many residents are not aware of how easy it is to request a spray cap from the fire department. Anyone over 18 years or over could go to their local firehouse and request a free spray cap installed at the hydrant of their choice. The HEAT team urges New Yorkers to report any illegally open fire hydrant to 311 immediately. We also advocate for the use of local pools, parks, and recreation centers to get through the heat waves of the summer. New York City is fortunate to have some of the cleanest and best tasting water in the cities in the world. DEP is also in charge of maintaining water supply network of 19 reservoirs and 3 control lakes in a nearly 2,000 square mile watershed, roughly the size of the state of Delaware, which extends 125 miles north and west of New York City. New York City water supply provides about 1 billion gallons of safe drinking water daily to New Yorkers. An illegally open fire hydrant limits the amount of water supply to a neighborhood. The HEAT program hires youth ages 14 to 24 through SoBro Summer Youth Employment program to work within the communities and share information about the dangers of illegal fire hydrant use. The HEAT team focuses their community outreach to Community Board 4 and 5 in the Bronx and Community Board 12 in Manhattan, all neighborhoods that have historically seen high rates of unauthorized fire hydrant misuse. The HEAT team canvasses the community boards to educate businesses and organizations and solicits their support to carry out HEAT's mission. The HEAT team also hosts presentations at local schools, parks, and libraries, community centers, and other neighborhood events, including National Night Out and community affairs. Last year, the HEAT team met with Bronx Borough President Ruben Diaz and the 44th Precinct Deputy at NYPD's 33rd Annual National Night Out. We will hand out some newsletters that will have more information about that. When canvassing, residents have constantly shared their concerns regarding the dangers to young children when playing with the fire hydrants. Many residents have witnessed children as young as 2 years old getting pushed under cars because of the powerful water pressure. The use of spray caps could prevent these type of accidents. We explained to residents that it might take a bit longer to get into the cool water and play, but it could save a lifetime of regret. While the HEAP program was created to educate New Yorkers on the fire hydrant misuse, it also educates and develops its team members' public speaking and leadership skills. They all have a chance to develop or refine these skills while caring and protecting New York City, the place they call home. HEAT is not only making the summer months safer for New Yorkers, but it's also strengthening the community involvement. HEAT program has its own newsletter called HEAT Bee, running since 2012. The weekly newsletter summarizes and highlights the activities, events, and merits of HEAT teams each summer. HEAT Bee motivates readers to follow the team's weekly accomplishments with captivating articles that inform and educate New Yorkers on HEAT mission. The article also covers HEAT's main events in the communities and the impact the HEAT team leaves behind. We have some copies and I'll hand them out. Now we have a short video which will provide a better understanding of the HEAT program. Thank you and enjoy. Yes. Technical difficulties.
My name is Naija Percivali, and I'm here from the Hydrant Education Action Team. We educate young adults about illegal opening of the fire hydrants. Our motto is to put a cap on it.
It's summertime in the Big Apple, which means temperatures here can soar to over 100 degrees. So with the mercury pushing triple digits, how do you keep your cool? We know that some New Yorkers see opening a hydrant as an easy way to cool off, but it's important for you to know that opening a fire hydrant without a spray cap is wasteful, dangerous, and illegal. New York's water supply is pressurized. An open hydrant can release more than 1,000 gallons of water in a minute. This helps get water to the top of tall buildings and to fight fires. But when too many hydrants are open, it can lower the water pressure in your neighborhood, making it harder for firefighters to save lives and difficult for some people to cook, clean, and bathe. At full pressure, the force from an open hydrant could easily push a child into oncoming traffic. And unfortunately, accidents have happened and people have been hurt. Fire hydrants with spray caps release up to 25 gallons of water a minute, enough to cool people down without putting anyone in danger. Anyone who's at least 18 years old can walk down to their local firehouse and ask how to get a spray cap put on a hydrant. So, if you see an open hydrant, please call 311 and ask them to put a cap on it.
Put a cap on it, it's refreshing.
Put a cap on it.
Put a cap on it.
Thank you. Do anybody have any questions or comments?
Are there any questions or comments? Yes, Cedric.
Good morning.
Who's responsible for the closure of the hydrants? Are the team people responsible? So let's say if the hydrant has been running since 8 o'clock in the morning, and now it's evening and everybody's left the scene of fun. Does the team then come out to the site and say, okay, let's look at this hydrant. Is it still running, affecting pressure? We need to turn it off, or how does that happen?
Yes.
You want me to take that?
Yeah, you.
I'm Vicki Hirschfeld. I am the director of the HEAT program. We do not have that power. What we do is we will call, we can make a phone call to 311. we can call the fire department and just say that we observe that there's a fire hydrant on full blast, but we do not have that control or that power.
Even if it's a heat turned on hydrant?
No, we don't turn hydrants on.
Okay.
We try to tell the residents in the community that are going to turn it on to use a cap.
Okay.
And not just because what they normally do, that question she asked earlier, you know, they get those cans and they scrape them, and we try to tell them instead to put a cap on the hydrant. Okay. But we don't encourage them to turn them on.
John Dudley.
Okay. Good morning.
Sorry.
No, that's okay. It would need to be called into 311, and our crews are responsible for turning them off. The heat team, their main objective is to go out and send the message not to open up hydrants. There's alternatives. Put the spray cap on it. Go to your local pool or playground. But my agency is really the one responsible for closing them.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
John Dudley.
Thank you. I have a question. To get a spray cap, I know you got to go to the local firehouse, right? Is there a form of a sort that you have to complete when the battalion commander or whoever there is assigned at the firehouse, when they give you the spray cap, do they know specifically the hydrant that you're looking to put the cap on? Or you can indiscriminately get the cap and select whatever, because there's some hydrants obviously that have custodian locks, some don't, right, have custodian locks. For those that don't, the hydrant can be open, they can put the cap on it at their discretion. For the ones that do have the custodian lock, how does that work? In terms of the process of securing the cabs?
Okay. My understanding is that if you're 18 or older, you just need to take your ID proving that to get the cab. Now, I've not went there, so I don't know what forms they may have to fill out.
All right.
I think there is a form you have to fill out. You have to show you're 18 and over. But also, just realize something. Just because you want a spray cap on a specific hydrant does not mean they will come out and put it there. The location has to be appropriate where there's not too many children playing that can get hurt by cars. They tend not to put it when there's two-way traffic or if it's a bus route. So there's some requirements associated with that. And the fire department would also want to know, do you have an event going on? Do you want it on a specific day turned on and then turned off? Okay. So it's not like, let me grab a spray cap and then just disappear with
it. So all those particulars are ironed out.
You can't just put a spray cap on every hydrant because there's parameters.
But they will actually do the installation. They will put the cap on.
Yes, and we do them as well. We actually provide the fire department, their main storehouse, with a whole bunch of these, and then they distribute them to each local firehouse.
Okay. Is it, let me just say, if there are designated times where water is going to be turned on or turned off, does the engine company actually do the turning on and the turning off?
Yes. I mean, if you tell them I'm having an event or I'm doing a play street or something and we would like to have a spray cap put on this date and time, they will come and turn it on and turn it off.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
Okay. Mr. Hall.
Hi, Bill Hall, Board 12. You mentioned earlier that you hire youth from 14 to 24.
Yes.
Is there a number or a location that the would you go to for the jobs in terms of application?
SoBro.
These are youth that are part of the SoBro Summer Youth Employment Program. Mm-hmm. So they've already been approved by SYEP and registered and enrolled, and that's where we get our youth from.
Okay, so you're not hiring, you pretty much have your staff.
Well, we hire them. So HEAT is a work site for summer youth. So we take on 50 young people for the HEAT program.
Okay, I guess my question is, do you already have those 50 young people, or are you hiring, are you in the process of hiring?
We're selecting now. But remember, they come out of the SYEP pool.
So they have to be in the pool?
Right.
Okay. And what do you have to do to get into that pool? I guess that's the next question.
Well, that you have to apply for the Summer Youth Employment
Program. For the
Summer
Youth Employment Program. Right. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Okay. Cedric?
Hi.
You were saying that there were designated community boards that you had looked at where this was a problem. What was the determinant that you picked that community board? Was it the flow of water over a particular time, like a year, 2 years, that you established, okay, these community boards are more problematic than other community boards?
Well, DEP actually would have to.
Yeah. So what we've done historically, we've had very high running hydrant complaints in community boards 4 and 5 in the Bronx and 12 in Manhattan. Throughout the years, the numbers have come down. The HEAT program has helped a lot since we initiated it. How many years ago? It's been a while.
7, I believe.
Right. It's definitely been several years that we've had the HEAT program going on. So the numbers definitely have come down. Every month I send around, by the way, your monthly stats. So definitely look at it. You'll see your running hydrant complaints have come down. I've noticed the decrease because I don't get that many complaints either. But traditionally, it's been community boards 4 and 5 and 12 in Manhattan that have had the worst running hydrant complaints for the summer months. That's why we've selected them. We used to have maps that would show the most problematic locations, and those we supply to SoBro so the HEAT teams can go out there and do outreach in those neighborhoods and those streets and so forth. Yeah.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Jeremy, let me get you first.
Thank you. So obviously those are very good questions some of my colleagues have asked in terms of like what's actually required, the form that's needed, and I know the fire department, at least when Roger was there, used to come to these meetings. There's a really nice video. I'm assuming that's being shared via social media, if it hasn't already been.
Well, we have put it on the SoBro website. And we do intend to have a social media component for this year and put all of the information on it. We have to get it all worked out.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Good. Now, I think you kind of answered my question, which was for people who open the hydrant to wash their cars and then walk away and leave the hydrant open. That's a big problem.
That's illegal.
Can you answer that? Yeah.
That's illegal. It needs to be reported so we can come out and turn the hydrant off. Also realize during the summer months when it gets really hot, we do have additional patrol crews that go overnight turning these hydrants off. But it's always helpful if it's reported to 311 so we can make sure we come out and shut
okay.
them.
Okay. Marisol.
You guys have enforcement powers when you find that these people are abusing the fire hydrant laws?
We do have DEP police. Usually if we have an issue, we notify the local precinct, and we've actually, sometimes we do have issues when we go to turn these hydrants off where we are confronted by people that get a little aggressive with us. So we do reach out to the local precinct who accompanies us to some of these locations when we do the night patrols, and they can assist if there's any incident.
But you haven't been able to issue summonses or anything?
So not that I'm aware of. Also, it's difficult to say. You need to see the person actually opening it. You can't just arrive to the location and the hydrant's on and somebody saying, oh, he did it. Well, you really need to catch the person in action doing that. Yeah.
Okay. Are there any other questions or comments? Yes, John?
Yeah. No, just quickly, if someone were caught in that instance, would it just be an administrative? I mean, what would be the nature of the enforcement?
I think it's $1,000 fine, $1,000 impossible, jail time.
So it would be like an ECB type of violation that would have a penalty rate?
Yes, I believe so.
At that scale?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I hope you're going to put in the amount of the fine when you do your social media blast.
When we used to have our posters, I recall some of our other posters definitely had the fine noted on them.
Right.
So definitely something to keep in mind when we do the social media aspect.
Right. Mm-hmm. Jeremy?
Unfortunately, that brings a question in. You may not have an immediate answer, but maybe you can get back to us in terms of how often is that fine actually issued?
Not that I'm aware of. I don't. I don't have any statistics on that. Yeah.
Because if it's not, if it's never enforced, it's like, I don't know, why advertise it? And, I mean, maybe I'll deter some people, but I feel like it's going to be a waste of time, unfortunately. It's a good idea, though.
It doesn't hurt to put it in print, which we've done that on our posters. Right. People need to be aware that it is an illegal activity right. to be opening it up. And the reasons are, you know, low water pressure in buildings, you're unable to fight fires from the hydrant, things of that nature. That's the whole idea of the message.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Angel?
So I work in Board 5. I live on Board 4. Where I live on College Avenue and 169th Street, in the summer it becomes hanging out in front of the building, loud noise, and the fire hydrant is constantly on. They come and turn it off, and they turn it on again. And it takes a while by the time the enforcements come back, and it's running at least 24 hours longer. The deterrence of these posters, is it going to be available so we can at least put them in front of our buildings?
Sobro can possibly do outreach in that location. I'm not sure if you've done that already.
We've been in all of the community board 4 and 5. We've walked
yes,
through the
I
neighborhood.
Know.
We'll do is we'll take that address and we'll make sure this summer that we make several trips to that area. We do put the posters up. The businesses in the communities will post their posters for us, and that's helpful. We go to the community centers and we give them the posters, and they post them up. But we will come in that community. We'll take the address, write it down, make sure
okay.
you have it. We'll take the address, and we'll make sure that we focus in that area this summer.
Thank you.
Okay, I want to thank you all for coming in and sharing with us. It's a very necessary program that you're doing, and we thank you for that.
Thank you for having us. We're going to hand out the newsletters and the fans.
Okay. Thank you again. I do have some announcements to make. What happened to them? Oh, they're in here. Of upcoming events. The borough president invites you to join him and the Bronx Muslim community to break the fast, which will take place on Tuesday, June 13th at 7 o'clock p.m. at the County Courthouse, 851 Grand Concourse in the Veterans Memorial Hall. The program will start at 7:30. With prayer and dinner. The seating is limited, so you have to call if you're planning to attend. The number is 718-590-3522, or you can email L Roldan, LROLDAN at bronxpp.nyc.gov. I also want to announce that there will be a Bronx Public Hearing Housing Authority Task Force public hearing on public safety at NYCHA houses. It's sponsored by the borough president, the district attorney, council members Richie Torres and Vanessa Gibson. It will be at two places on two different dates. The first one is this evening at 6 o'clock at Phipps Neighborhood Sotomayor Houses at 1000 Rosedale Avenue. And you can come and express your concerns regarding public safety at... That's for Bronx North at NYCHA Development. The other one is for Bronx South. It will take place on Thursday, June 15th at 6 o'clock at Claremont Community Center, 489 East 169th Street. I also want to announce that the Bronx Summer Walk, 7th Annual Bronx Summer Walk, will take place at Burnside Avenue between Jerome and Davidson Avenue. It will take place on three Saturdays. Are these three Saturdays, July 22nd, July 29th, and August 5th. It's really a beautiful event. I go practically every year. And it's hosted by Captain Annette DeJesus, plus other special guests. Board 5 or Davidson Community Center also wanted me to announce that they have a position open as program manager. You can get the details from Angel on that, okay? And with that, if there's no other announcements or comments, this meeting is adjourned. Thank you.
We are together. And for the last 20 years, we have been building on a vision to share our views, our voices on our channels. We are the Bronx. We are BronxNet.
I got this as a paid internship. Spending my time here, I really enjoyed the people that work here. I enjoy what goes on behind the scenes.
So far, I've learned how to operate a camera, how to host. I learned how to control audio.
My first time hosting was really nerve-wracking. But I really enjoyed it because it was a new experience.
Coming to you from our BronxNet studios, four new shows highlighting some of the best of the Bronx has to offer. We sit down with political leaders on in the district and discuss local legislation, events, and issues. See how the community and business come together with The Bronx Now on BronxNet. Nosotros features leaders from a Latino community. Meet those who are moving to make a difference in public service, business, arts, and culture. Looking for new and exciting dining experiences? Then you'll want to savor the Bronx and try new restaurants and eateries that fill the borough with delicious dishes. We have it all, so experience the Bronx in new and fresh ways on BronxNet.
From the north to the south to the west to the east, we are expanding our services
and upgrading technology at Lehman College. And now, Bronxites have an innovative media production facility in the East Bronx at Mercy College in the Hutch Metro Center. The windows on the East Bronx studio, a state-of-the-art control room, media labs for production and training, and other media-capable spaces. Training, workforce development, leading-edge technology, and programs that help you share your ideas, your voice, on your channels, locally and globally. Build media and technology skills at BronxNet, and build your dreams.
Manhattan and west of the sound, that's where you'll find me hanging around. You can keep Chelsea and Sutton and the great white way. The Bronx is where I wanna stay. From Fordham Road to City Isle, the folks all greet you with a smile. Strolling up the concourse on a summer's day, we'll tell you why I'll never stray. 4th of July, out at Orchard Beach, 'neath the summer sky of blue. Sunday afternoon, going through the zoo. And don't forget, we've got the Yankees too. So now you know never roam far from the place that I call home. You'll never find a better place to be. Yes, the Bronx is all right with me.
Para mí, lo que significa la comunidad latina es una comunidad trabajadora, una comunidad de fe, de familia, una comunidad de coraje.
¿Qué sientes cuando ellos te dicen, Rubencito, una foto, ven para acá, como si fueras el hijo de ellos?
Me siento orgulloso, me siento como si fuera una bendición, me siento que humilde, me siento en una forma de que, mira, este es el pueblo donde yo trabajo para, por ellos. Y tomarse una foto con una persona, eso es lo menos que un sirviente público puede hacer por el pueblo.
Ah, ¿qué te digo? Cuando tú siembras, cosechas. Y tiene que ser una buena semilla para que tengas un buen fruto. Y ese es mi fruto, mi familia, mis nietos y toda la gente que alrededor. ¡Ay, no!
Lo que uno tiene que hacer es actualmente poner el ojo a dónde es que tú vas y trabajar fuerte. Uno puede estudiar, estudiar y estudiar, y la persona puede ganarse la vida en un trabajo. Pero uno no tiene que estudiar, estudiar, estudiar. Uno puede trabajar, trabajar y trabajar fuertemente para lograr lo mismo.
Y cuando viene el mes de febrero, tú no sabes lo que siento yo. 21 de enero al 27 de febrero es algo que me llena de un orgullo, que me la sangre, mi piel, mi pecho se rebosa de orgullo.
Charlie's Bar and Kitchen is a new American restaurant in the South Bronx. We have a seasonal menu, fresh ingredients that change over the seasons depending on what's available. We try and get to local farmers markets as much as we can. Keep the food as fresh as possible. The building is a beautiful historic piano factory. It is a landmark building. I think there's a sense of that when you feel and walk into the space. It has a very warm, cozy kind of environment, candle lit, intimate mood, and the exposed bricks and the wall. The fact that it's an old charming landmark building from the late 1800s, I think adds to our character. So anybody who comes into the restaurant normally doesn't notice immediately why the place is called Charlie's. And so the theme of the place being Charlie's, no apostrophe, Charlie's plural, is more than one Charlie. So it becomes blatantly obvious towards the end when you're faced against this mural up against the wall of all these Charlies. But it's all about famous Charlies. So, yeah, Charlie's Bar and Kitchen, I mean, the name itself, Bar and Kitchen. So we started off the idea that we were prominently a bar. But some people do see us now more as a kitchen. They come here more to dine. It's a new American restaurant with slightly Southern influences. Because of the seasonal menu, we get to change up the ingredients, which gives us the ability to change up the menu. As a location, I think we've captured a good kind of audience, a local audience, a Bronx audience who now looking for something a little different, come over to come see us.
Fusion restaurant in the South Bronx. When we built the restaurant, we put our heart and soul into it. We wanted something that people will walk in and will see the restaurant and say, wow. And the moment it's combined with the taste of the food, which is also unique, gives you a taste of Asian places in the world.
Our staple here is the tuna bruschetta. It's amazing. People rave about it. It's what a lot of people come here for. They're like, somebody told me to try something that comes on this crispy rice. It's amazing. It's crispy rice, guacamole, spicy tuna, ingredients that people really, really love.
Our goal here is not just to make amazing food or nice decor or be nice. It's the whole thing. I want people to experience something that they've never experienced anywhere in the world. Good service, good food, and that it looks decent and nice. And when they're happy, it's for me like I just had an amazing epiphany. So it's the fourth year that we participate in this, and we are very, very happy to do it because it, for us, it's giving back to the community that supported us since day one.
Bistro SK, it's a French bistro that we opened 6 years ago.
We are the only French restaurant in all of the Bronx.
It took me 4.5 months to do the whole thing, from the wallpaper to the floor, to the sconces, to the decor. I did everything by myself.
People come in here and immediately they feel very homey. It's because we took literally the pictures off the wall of our home and brought them down and put them in the restaurant. And we want just the opposite. We want people to feel that warm and welcome when they come in here. We get a lot of business from Manhattan customers, even people from Brooklyn come, Westchester, Connecticut, but we have a lot of local Bronx people that come here as well, and a lot of City Islanders that come.
All dishes, we design them to our taste. Salmon is a piece of salmon fillet, cut like as a steak. It's pan roasted. We serve it with a sage sauce with a little bit of cream. And we serve it with the black olive mashed potato and with some vegetables. It's pan-seared. Savor the Bronx, it's a possibility for us to put ourselves on a map in Bronx because people in the Bronx, let's tell the truth, they don't necessarily go to a French restaurant in the first place, and especially if they come to City Island. My goal was to create something that was very, I'm French myself, so my goal was to bring a little part of my country here. And the best thing you can tell me when you come to my place is like, oh, you feel in France.
Yeah.
Then I feel that I've done my job.
Amelia's Restaurant, located in Little Italy in the Bronx on Arthur Avenue. My dad and his partner started it about 20 years ago.
And I love to be on Arthur Avenue because it's the place where I can really cook the way I want.
My dad is from Palermo and our menu consists mostly of Southern Italian cooking.
We have a beautiful dish we call pescatore that is made with shrimp. We have mussels, we have clams, and it gives a nice flavor to the sauce. It's a good condiment for the linguine that we use. We make our manigotti, we make our own gnocchi like the old days by hand.
I think people feel very comfortable because we tend to make them feel at home. I think that the patio is unique to the area.
We have a nice waterfall, nice relaxing.
It's kind of like a little haven in the middle of the Bronx. People come in and they're like, wow, this is kind of cool. Where did this come from? The community is just a fun place to be. There's always something going on. If you come at Christmas time, there's lines to get into the stores because people are buying their meat, they're getting their food, they're gathering with family and friends to celebrate the holidays. If you come in the summer, there's usually feasts going on.
What makes Amelia unique is the neighborhood. We're in an area where we buy everything fresh every day. We can buy the meat, we can buy the fish, we can buy the vegetable every day because we have everything within reach.
People keep coming back, love the food.
Arthur Avenue is a good place, and we are to stay.
Salut!
Thank you.
Tidal Brothers is located on Arthur Avenue and East 186th Street. It's been 101 years. My three sons are with me in this business. The business was started by my father and my uncle, who were immigrants from Austria. And they rented this store on the corner, which is here now. The landlord at the time told my father that, you know, if people knew that you were Jewish, they would not shop here. So they decided during the 1930s, with the stuff that was going on in Europe, they put a Jewish star in the front. And it's been there since. After my father and uncle passed away, it was my brothers and I. Unfortunately, my brothers are no longer here, and my sons decided to come into the business and do what we do now.
We provide all the pizzerias and restaurants with tomatoes, olive oil, cheeses. We bring them in from Sardinia, Sicily, Tuscany, Rome.
My son loves Italy, Eddie, and he makes the deals in Italy, and he meets new people.
Come si va? Tutto bene. You name it, we have it. If it's Italian, we have it.
Tidal Brothers supplies things that they cannot get in their neighborhood. 95% is imported items.
The olive oils here are sensational. The olive oil we have from Sardinia is like a Sicilian, a heavy oil with a lot of flavor.
This is edible oil, produced and packed in Lucca, Italy. It's a very good quality oil, perfect for frying, dipping salads.
People come down for the price, they come down for the quality, and they come down for the service.
Take a look around. You can ask some of our customers why they come here.
Their provisions are fabulous. Fresh prosciutto all the time, fresh Italian cold cuts from pastas, from sauces, to probably one of the best sausage makers in New York City.
These sausages are produced here. It's a production called Alps, a company called Alps. This has got a little fennel in it. It's called a cacciatorini, and this is without fennel. And the super side match up great with the Parmigiano and the provolone.
So you can find Parmigiano Reggiano, Romano cheese.
We have here a Parmigiano Reggiano, which is probably the number one selling cheese in the world. It's a cow's milk cheese produced in the region of Emilia Romagna. With antipasto, you want something sharp or mild? Mild. I mean, this is a staple. This is Reggiano. This is the number one selling cheese in the world. The tomatoes here are sensational. We have tomatoes from Salerno, from San Marzano, which is a region by a volcano in Salerno, where the volcanic soil produces a sweeter tomato.
Well, it's fast-paced, high energy. Could be challenging at some times, but we all get along.
We take a lot of time and giving people great products at great prices.
It's fun, and you interact with the customers, which is the best part.
The chemistry is good, the people work together, and we're all basically happy.
Now I appreciate what it really is about. It's about family. I get to see my kids every day. It's a family business. You can call it a mom and pop business, but I think it became a little more than that.